Often while discussing capital markets with your friends or colleagues, you must have come across terms such as forwards, futures, call options, put options, and so on. Well, all these terms are derivative contracts. These are used for yield enhancement or hedging the risks. Hello everyone, welcome to my channel Raise Your Acumen. This is Harshal Patil, I am a chartered accountant, and in this video, we'll learn about the basics of derivative contracts. Before we begin, do subscribe to my channel and hit the bell icon to get notified about the short and informative content which will up your acumen. Now, before discussing the financial meaning of derivatives, let us understand what does derivative mean in general terms. So, derivative basically means something derived. It is something which derives its value from the base source. Let's take example of doctors. Doctors get recognized as a medical professional for the degree they hold. So in a way, this medical degree is an underlying asset, and the person holding the degree is a derivative. Their value gets increased or recognized when they earn that degree. So from a finance perspective, derivative is a financial product or financial instrument whose value is to be derived from the value of underlying asset such as equity, forex or commodity, or the value of set of underlying assets like an index. There are four basic types of derivative contracts: forward contract, futures contract, options, and swaps. Let us understand forward contract with the help of an example. Suppose a buyer and a seller enter into an agreement on 1st September 2020. The agreement is to purchase 100 ounces of gold on 30th December 2020 at ₹1,50,000 per ounce. So in this case, the rate per ounce which the buyer and the seller have decided to transact on 30th December 2020 is the forward rate. In this agreement, the buyer is said to be long and the seller is said to be short. So on expiry of the forward contract, that is on 30th December 2020, the buyer is obligated to pay 1.5 crores and take delivery of 100 ounces of gold. And similarly, the seller is obligated to accept 1.5 crores and give 100 ounces of gold to the buyer. So, a forward contract is an agreement between a buyer and a seller, obligating the seller to deliver a specified asset of specified quality and quantity to the buyer on a specified date at a specified place. And the buyer, in turn, is obligated to pay the seller a pre-negotiated price in exchange of delivery. Similarly, let us understand futures contract with the help of an example. So on 1st September 2020, buyer and seller enters into a 5000 kgs corn futures contract at rupees 5 per kg. The buyer is said to be long and the seller is said to be short. Unlike forward contract, the buyer and seller enter into a contract through an intermediary, say a stock exchange. The futures here are, say, November 20 expiry futures, that is, the contract will expire in November 20. Now these futures are traded on stock exchange on daily basis up until their expiry. And on the next trading day, November 20 futures close at rupees 5.2 per kg. Due to this, the buyer is at a gain of 1000 rupees and the seller is at a loss of 1000 rupees. Now this gain or loss is notional in nature until the point where the contract is settled or the futures expire. So from this we understand that a futures contract is an agreement between two parties that commits one party to buy an underlying financial instrument or commodity and the other party to sell a financial instrument or commodity at a specific price at a future date. Now the agreement is completed at a specified expiration date by physical delivery or cash settlement or offset prior to the expiration date. With the understanding of forwards and futures, let us move on to options contract. An options contract offers the holder the opportunity to buy or sell the underlying asset depending on the type of contract they hold. Unlike futures, the holder is not required to buy or sell the asset if they choose not to. Now, options can be understood as a privilege sold by one party to another that gives buyer the right but not the obligation to buy or sell any underlying at an agreed upon price within certain period or on a specified date, regardless of the changes in underlying's market price during that period. The two main classifications under option are call options, which allows the holder to buy the asset at a stated price within a specific time frame, and put options, which allows the holder to sell the asset at a stated price within a specific time frame. The last type of derivative that we are going to discuss in this video is swaps. Now let us again take an example to understand how a swap arrangement works. So in this case, A Limited and B Limited have a fund requirement of 100 crore rupees. Now A's banker, that is B1, has sanctioned the 100 crore rupee loan at a fixed rate of 12%. Whereas B Limited banker, that is B2, has sanctioned the 100 crore rupee loan at MIBOR plus 2%. Now this MIBOR, or otherwise called as Mumbai Interbank Offered Rate, is the rate of interest charged by a bank on a short-term loan to another bank. It is calculated on daily basis, thus making it variable in nature. Okay, now coming back to the illustration, A Limited's view is that the fixed rate of 12% is too high and they are expecting the MIBOR to reduce. They are actually favoring a loan at MIBOR rates. However, they are not able to get that from the bank. B Limited's view is that the MIBOR will increase in the future and they are favoring a loan at a fixed interest rate as they want to keep their cash flow steady. Now, in order to swap their interest payments, both these companies decided to enter into a swap arrangement through an intermediary bank. In the swap arrangement, it was decided that A Limited will give 100 crore rupee loan to B Limited at 11% per annum, and B Limited will give a 100 crore rupee loan to A Limited at MIBOR plus 1%. In such swap arrangements, the principal amount is notional, that is, it is just an exchange of interest rates. Let us take a look at how the cash flows of both A Limited and B Limited will be in the coming years. So now in the first year, when the MIBOR is at 8%, A Limited will pay to its banker B1 12%, and under the swap arrangement, A Limited will receive from B Limited fixed interest at the rate of 11%, and A Limited will pay to B Limited MIBOR plus 1%, that is 9%. So overall, the interest cost to A Limited will be 10%. And similarly, B Limited will pay to its banker B2 MIBOR plus 2%, that is 10%. And under the swap arrangement, B Limited will receive from A Limited MIBOR plus 1%, that is 9%. And B Limited will pay to A Limited fixed interest of 11%. So overall, the interest cost to B Limited will be 12%. Let's move on to year 2, where MIBOR has increased to 12% from 8%. Now A Limited will pay to its banker B1 12%. And under the swap arrangement, A Limited will receive from B Limited fixed interest at the rate of 11%. And A Limited will pay to B Limited MIBOR plus 1%, that is 13%. So overall, the interest cost to A Limited will be 14%. And similarly, B Limited will pay to its banker B2 MIBOR plus 2%, that is 14%. And under the swap arrangement, B Limited will receive from A Limited MIBOR plus 1%, that is 13%. And B Limited will pay A Limited fixed interest of 11%. So overall, the interest cost to B Limited will be 12%. So from this swap transaction, we can see how A Limited and B Limited have changed the nature of their cash flows. If you observe, the overall interest cost to B Limited is 12%, no matter what the MIBOR is. They have changed the nature of their cash flows from variable to fixed. Now in a practical scenario, the intermediary bank charges commission on both legs of transactions in swap arrangements. And this type of arrangement that we saw is known as interest rate swap. So from the illustration, we can understand that a swap is a derivative contract through which two parties exchange the cash flows or liabilities from two different financial instruments. Now most swaps involve cash flows based on notional principal amount. Under swap arrangement, one cash flow is generally fixed while the other is variable. And swap arrangements are based on a benchmark interest rate or floating currency exchange rate or index price. Now swaps do not trade on exchanges and retail investors do not generally engage in swaps. Rather, swaps are over-the-counter contracts primarily between the businesses or financial institutions that are customized to the needs of both parties. Now that we have covered the basic concept of derivative instruments, let us understand the usage of these derivatives for different users. So a corporation uses derivatives to hedge currency risk and inventory risk. Individual investors use derivatives for speculation, hedging, and yield enhancements. Institutional investors use derivatives for hedging asset allocation, yield enhancement, and to avail arbitrage opportunities. And dealers use derivatives for hedging position taking, exploiting inefficiencies, and earning dealer spreads. So this was all about the derivatives. Hope you found this useful. Please do like and share this video. Do subscribe to this channel to access such informative content. Do let me know your queries, suggestions in the comment box below. Also, you can connect with me on LinkedIn. I have given my profile link in the description below. Thanks for watching.